Hello friends, welcome to E-Pathshala. I am Shagun Sharma, Assistant Professor in Political Science in Government College for Girls, Sector 42, Chandigarh. The module we are going to discuss today is Global Governance. With the coming of globalization, several new actors came into being. One of that is the concept of global governance. With the end of Cold War, these institutions came together with various sovereign states and new social movements. Global governance has taught the current international discipline that with the end of globalization, new social movements can come. The concept of global governance is very wide in terms of activities, actors involved in this mechanism, and the issues which it addresses. Many scholars have tried to define global governance, yet there does not exist any one widely accepted definition of global governance. In this reader, we would try to have a look at some scholars and their definitions and try to find out some common characteristics, features of global governance. The term governance has emerged from Latin word gubernator, which literally means a person who is the source of authority and also self-acting contrivance for regulating to ensure regulation and control. The original meaning of the word governance manifests that government is a regulatory mechanism which gives a pattern to the behavior of actors involved at global level. Governance and government are two different concepts. Government is a structure while governance is a process or function, and process needs to be sanctioned by the masses. Earlier, the term governance was having domestic political connotation, but now it is used beyond the politics of state as well. When we study the concept of global governance, we find that there is disagreement regarding both the concepts, global as well as governance. The term global itself is widely defined and used as a system, which not only includes state as a component, but also gives space to other actors, such as multinational corporations, NGOs, INGOs, social movements, and public-private partnerships. Global governance is also closely associated with the emergence of new public management strategies of 1980s, which emphasize on cost and efficiency. It is closer to corporate governance, which stresses more managerial skills of private sector to be adopted by public sector to achieve goals efficiently. However, by the analysis of these definitions, we have developed a fair understanding of what exactly global governance is, and we can sum up these definitions in few characteristics, features of global governance. One of the unanimously accepted features of global governance is that it is a set of rules for organized and patterned of different actors at international level. It provides an innovative way for solving newly emerged problems due to the increased activity of different actors which do not fall under the authority area of individual states. Global governance gives space to many actors to interact and provide solution to common problems of humankind across the globe. Therefore, global governance can be understood as a new regulating mechanism which authoritatively regulates the behavior of different actors in order to establish a politically secured and socially healthy atmosphere for humankind to grow. Contextualizing global governance in IR. This section would deal with the different discourses on global governance and will throw some light on the connection between polity, society, economy, and governance. The main focus of this section would be on the ideal development of the concept of global governance. The study of different actors other than states at international level would help in understanding the concept partially. To have a holistic understanding of global governance, we need to contextualize the concept in different debates in IR. The emerging debates on global governance in IR revolves around state-centered and non-state account of political order. Globalization has brought changes not only in economic sphere and increased economic interdependence, but it has also led to massive change in society, polity, and even in the environment which we live in. Current debates on global governance are concentrated on assessing the role of plethora of actors in international relations, which has gained prominence in present time. Global governance has been used as a reference point by the scholars who do not believe in the anarchical international system where the sovereign states are embedded. The system of global governance is basically a set of social organization and political decision making which has not emerged from state and even not directed towards it. The discourses on global governance has brought to the light the paradigmatic shift from state-centric approach to non-state actor-centric approach in IR, which further help in comprehending the pattern of behavior at international level. The study of international relations deal with political interactions of states. However, global governance is known for focusing on multi-level interaction at international, national and regional and local level. In the next section of the reader, we would discuss about the theories of IR and try to understand different theoretical interpretations of global governance. Theoretical analysis of global governance will help in answering certain questions which have emerged with the emergence of global governance as an institution in international politics. The first question which theoretical debate dwells upon is the world order on the structure of world politics in present time and the position of state in the current world order. The study of the position of state is relative in the sense that the role of other actors should also be taken into consideration while discussing the role of state and also the distribution of power among actors. Global governance is an integral part of the study of international relations, and thus it is pertinent to first understand global governance in the light of different theories of IR so that conceptualization of global governance would become easy in fast-changing international scenario. In this section, we would discuss about realist, liberal and institutionalist, pluralistic, critical and constructivist theories of IR and how they interpret global governance. Realist interpretation of global governance. Political realism begins with Niccolo Machiavelli and Thomas Hobbes. Machiavelli, in his famous book The Prince, writes, "Should do everything and anything to retain power and secure state from any internal turmoil and external invasions." Hobbes, in his book Leviathan, writes that human beings by their very nature are selfish, nasty and brutish. Reinhold Niebuhr and Hans Morgenthau are exponents of classic of IR. Though the classical IR realists are different from Machiavelli on the issue of morality, as it does not believe in compliance of morality by the prince, whereas the scholars of IR questions the moral obligation and ignorance of political realities. A closer analysis of the debate on realism in IR makes it clear that there prevails anarchy in international politics and sovereign states are the most important actors and their capabilities are determined by the powers they possess. Though scholars like Carr have accepted the existence of some non-state actors, he hasn't given much importance to them. In that case, global governance or any global regime is considered as a means of legal coercion on weaker states. Realist scholars are of the view that states are rational and autonomous actors and they form an association or becomes a part of an international organization only to increase their power against their enemies. Liberal and institutional interpretation of global governance. Liberal theory provides a very optimistic view of international relations. John Locke, considered as the father of classical liberalism, opines that the state of nature was the condition in which people used to cooperate with each other and live with harmony. According to him, human beings possess reason and tolerance. The most contested issue between realists and liberals was ethical and moral principles. Liberals were criticized for lacking pragmatic view on international relations and they were labeled as idealists or utopians. Liberal institutionalists postulate the view that the international institutions can make states to cooperate with each other as there exists the commonality of interests among them. Institutionalists also blame realism for giving overemphasis to conflict and underestimating the capabilities of international institutions in bringing about cooperation. Institutionalists are of the view that no hierarchy of issues exists in the arena of international politics as propagated by realists. Though the realist critics of institutionalism argue that international organizations could not play an effective role during Cold War and they were handicapped by the influence of US and Soviet Russia, most of the decisions were taken under the pressure of one of the superpowers. Helen Milner criticizes both liberal and realist theory for ignoring the importance of domestic forces and policies in fostering cooperation at international level and dealing with moral and ethical issues. Pluralistic interpretation of global governance. Pluralistic theory of global governance came into prominence with the work of Robert Cohen and Joseph Nye during 1970s as they tried to bring an alternative theory to neorealism. Though their work on complex interdependence and multiple access channels, they comprehended the concept of transnationalism. The pluralistic theory of global governance premised upon the idea that IR is not only dominated by state actors, but also there are many non-state actors including NGOs, civil society organizations, social movement have played a constructive role in shaping the order at global level. Pluralistic paradigms help us to understand global governance beyond the conception of interest and hegemony of states, which was considered to determine the structure of global governance structure. Mansbach has talked about six types of actors which can play a constitutive role in global governance. Interstate governmental actors, interstate non-governmental actors, nation states, governmental non-central actors, non-government actors and individuals as an actor. Regime theory and global governance. Regime theory was promoted by Orrin Young in the beginning of 1990s, just after the expansion of liberal institutionalism. According to him, regime is necessary to solve the problems which can be solved only by collective action and effective decision making. Krasner writes about regime that it involves around norms, rules, principles and decision making procedures around which other actors' expectations converge in a given area of international relations. After 1990s, critical theory became popular as global governance theory. Regime is a set of rules and procedures, while governance is a broader term and also includes implementation, monitoring, and implementation. Stephen Krasner has talked about three models of regime: structuralist, modified, and Grotian model. Critical theory of IR and global governance. Critical theory, rather than negating neorealistic and neoliberal institutional approaches to IR, takes into account their explanation of international institutions which say that regimes and their power to govern world politics is basically a mechanism to overcome political market failure. The reason behind the emergence of critical theory in the failure of pre-existing theory to make into consideration the role of state actors such as social movements, epistemic communities, non-governmental organizations, and civil society organizations while explaining the world political order. Critical theorists are skeptical about international regimes or global governing authorities. As for them, they are dominated by elites and hegemonic power, and more than cooperation, they are based on coercive interaction among states. Elite Western countries dominate the international organization, and other weak states do not have voice in decision making, so it should be restricted. They basically contest against the current design of global governing mechanism which lack democratic participation and thus they should be done away with. However, critical theory could not provide any substantial way out and it only criticizes the current order. Constructivist explanation of global governance. During 1980s, constructivism emerged as a counterattack on existing realist and liberal theories. Constructivism is basically an extension of critical theories of IR which criticize realism and liberalism for failing to predict the end of Cold War challenges following that ending. Constructivism basically revolves around four core concepts: norms, discourses, identity, and socialization. In contrast to institutionalism, which postulates the idea of complex interdependence and international institution to regulate the activities of actors at international level, constructivism considers the world politics as a sphere of interaction for a plethora of actors. According to them, World politics is shaped by the identities and practices of actors and also by constantly changing normative institutional structure. Ruzno's governance without governance. Global governance is the set of formal rules for the management of international affairs. He further writes that definitely United Nations and states government are very important, but they are only part of full picture. According to him, global governance includes a system of rule from family to an international organization level in which goals are pursued with the help of control and which has transnational repercussions. He writes that interdependence is the root of governance, and he narrows down the concept of governance to the level not only to the region, state and city but to family as well, and writes that decision taken at micro level such as family can be repercussion at macro level or for that matter global level. Ruzno has provided an all-inclusive picture of global governance, but at last he writes that this process is still evolving and changing with the new demands and problems. Globalization and global governance. If we trace the history of global interaction, we find that the most notable interaction which had an impact on international affairs was colonialism or imperialism. During the 19th and 20th century, imperialism dominated the world politics. After the end of colonialism, in the latter half of 20th century, world witnessed change in trade patterns in world economy. Now the sovereign states were not playing the role of regulator as the trade did not concede to physical boundary anymore. This process led to economic globalization, which ultimately led to free flow of everything everywhere. To understand the impact of globalization on global governance, it is pertinent to understand transnational relations first. Globalization and its impact on IR is the most debatable issue in last three decades, and Cohen's complex interdependence, Fukuyama's end of history, and Ruzno's governance without government. Thus, transnational relation does not limit to the interaction among states, but it is related to the interaction at societal level where various institutions and non-state actors get involved. Transnational was followed by United Nations, multilateralism and organization reform within the organization. UN through its group of organization establishes a normative structure and provides a mechanism to solve the problems which could not be controlled by states alone. In the post-Cold War era, when socialism was declared as a flawed ideology and liberalization, privatization and globalization began to dominate the world economy, many problems crept in the international arena. Multinational corporations, financial markets, lobbyist groups and other pressure groups were dominating the global policy making, which has had adverse social, political and economic impacts on the third world countries. Actors of global governance and their role. In the last century, the debate on global governance was mostly focused on the question of who governs whom. Are states dominating over global institutions or vice versa? Realist theory started with the conception of state as a primary actor, and liberals had faith in world organizations on the other hand, while the neo approaches of both the ideologies seem to be conceding the fact that states are the primary movers in international affairs, but world organizations are important in shaping the course of their relationship. Now the debate was more about how much they are effective in bringing about the solution to world problems and normalizing the relationship among states. Globalization has resulted in development of new technologies which have made human life easier. However, these technologies have also affected human life adversely in many parts of the world. Since NGOs work at ground level, they have better understanding of these ground realities and they are considered to be more sensitive towards the social setup and environment. Lack of information and transparency make the market more vulnerable of financial crisis, as we had witnessed during 1990s, and economic slowdown of 2008 was also caused by the wrong judgment of risk-taking capacity of commercial banks and debtors. Next come in this section on the actors of global governance are civil society organizational and transnational networks, which basically work against the democratic deficit in the organization of global governance. As state represent public, civil society organizations represent public interest, and many a time they represent those interests which are common in almost every society, despite of being cultural and ethnic plurality, such as human rights and environmental degradation. In the 21st century, the arena of global governance has been increased in every aspect of human life, and so is the variety and number of actors. Global governance actors are not only international, global and multilateral organizations, but also NGOs, CSOs, social movements, even a small individual initiative which has something to do with public interest is a part of global governance. Global governance and global public good, third world perspective. In the present time, half of the population in world lives on under $2 per day, and the gap between rich and poor is widening despite gradually. An interesting study by utilitarian ethicist Peter Singer writes that dozens of these kinds of people can be taken out of destitution by an US and EU citizen if they just reduce 20% of their expenditure and give that to Oxfam or UNICEF. Robert Cox has termed global governance as nebulose, which signifies the accumulation of ideological cloud which has brought the international social elite like Reaganism, Thatcherism together to respond to the needs of world market. Because of the influence of these elites, these institutions majorly worked under their supervision and tried to serve their purpose in international arena. In the present time, when liberalization is the moving force in international arena, all the countries, whether developing or underdeveloped, are conceding in to, even if it results in widening gap between rich and poor at economic levels. One of the recent developments in the international arena is that because of liberalization, many social movements have emerged which are contesting the forces of globalization, like Occupy Wall Street movement against raising unemployment, feminist movements, and anti-nuclear movements. The analysis of the most of the global regimes shows that developed countries like US and EU have played a vital role in the emergence of regimes and set the code of conduct for participating members, but they themselves abstained from complying with the principles of the regimes. The best example of this is the Rio Conference on Environment and the Kyoto Protocol on Reduction of Carbon Emissions, which was the brainchild of these countries, was never compiled by them. These countries boast for democratic ideals, but when it comes to compliance, they give primary importance to their interest. Most of the developing countries are treated mere as a member of the global governing authorities and not as an equal partner, and they hardly have any voice in the decision making. G4, which includes India, Brazil, Germany and Japan, have been trying very hard from last few years to get permanent membership in UNSC, which will make it more democratic, but this struggle does not seem to be concluded positively in near future. All these issues raises questions against the setup of global governance, which is considered to be working for greater public good at global level. They are functioning under the influence of developed countries and delegation of function and authority to provide actors make it mandatory to reassess the justification of the existence of these organizations. Now let us summarize this module. UK Prime Minister Gordon Brown in 2009 in Davos in World Economic Forum Summit said that we people will have to pay the price for this massive human catastrophe if we do not stop this extreme climate change and world poverty. But nothing has changed even since 1972, when first conference on climate change was held in Stockholm. So we need to pay the price for this. In fact, one such method is to give more voice to the people who are at the receiving end of these institutions. The institutions at global level, especially NGOs, they should have a voice in policy making of these institutions.